Hey, everybody, welcome to the official Do Good Better podcast. I'm your host, Patrick Kirby. Of course, we talk to small nonprofits doing great big things. Small nonprofits also need to think about great big things in a time where we're just kind of sitting at home and we're wondering what our next steps are. And we need to kind of figure out where to start, what to do, what path to go on. And so we're kind of bringing on our favorite human beings as guest experts to help the nonprofit world. And I am stoked to welcome our guests today. Jay, how are you? It's Jay Peltier. He is the partner at Dale Carnegie up here in the in flyover country,
yeah.
North Dakota. I'm ecstatic to know him as a human being. He's one of my favorite people to chat with, talk business with, talk personal stuff with. And I'm excited to bring you into the nonprofit world, my friend. Jay, how are you? Thanks for being a part of the official Do Good Better podcast.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Patrick. Doing well. It's a beautiful, finally sunny day in Fargo. So that's been it's been enjoyable as we've, I think I saw a meme yesterday and people feel like it snowed 72 times in the last 24 hours, which I think is pretty accurate, actually.
Very accurate. I don't know how, I don't know really the scientific benefits to having at least 15 minutes of vitamin D on your face in sun form, but it feels like we've made the corner and we turned it. I feel like that's the thing. And I think a lot of nonprofits are looking for a moment where they can turn the corner, kind of looking at this, this pandemic, looking at this kind of shutdown. They're looking for ways out. And that's why you are here, my friend. You talk a lot about not only some Dale Carnegie stuff, which is great, but you talk a lot about grit and how we sort of buckle down and buck up. And I'm excited to talk about it with you today. Before that, people are scrolling through. They're saying, ah, this guy, Dale Carnegie, Jay, this sounds great. Give us a 5,000-foot view on who you are, what you do, and there, I'm setting the table. Who are you? Why are you here?
Yeah, well, first of all, I appreciate you having me here. You know, I grew up small town North Dakota, little place called Harvey. You know, proud Hornet, went to North Dakota State, moved to Minneapolis, got my first job with a home building company. 2 months in, they laid off pretty much everyone in the company. So it was a little bit crazy times, became a recruiter, got bored recruiting because I was sitting behind a computer doing this for 8 hours a day, asking the same questions for 15 minutes at a time. At that time, I was coaching track and field and found out that I could actually teach business to high school kids. So I applied for every job in the country that was open in teaching business and social studies. Got a part-time opportunity in Colorado Springs, packed everything up. I applied, interviewed, moved, and started in 4 days. It was awesome. Did that for 6 years and then, you know, really kind of found out that, you know, I'd hit my glass ceiling in education and wanted to challenge myself a little bit more, and also the way education was going kind of, you know, wasn't really matched with my value system. So I got into entrepreneurship, did a little investing, was a realtor for a while, and then this opportunity to come back to North Dakota and be majority owner in Dale Carnegie presented itself, and I didn't know much about Dale Carnegie. I'd never taken a course. So I asked the owners, like, hey, is there a book I can read? And they kind of laughed like I was an idiot, which I'm sure anybody in the world would. And it's like, oh, yeah, How to Win Friends and Influence People. Oof.
That one. Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so moved back, and we've been here for about 2 years. And, you know, it's been a lot of fun. My business partner, Bethany, and I have been rolling with this thing for a couple years. And, you know, now I'm facilitating Dale Carnegie courses, doing keynotes, and doing what I can to get involved in the community and truly just help out in any way I possibly can. So that's kind of where I'm at today. You know, I'm coaching high school track again, so that's been an interesting little battle as well, but it's been fun to be a part of the community again.
I think it's wonderful. And again, taking some Dale Carnegie pieces, taking what you learned in coaching, taking what you learned in business, these are all the outside influences that I think nonprofits need to listen to and research and study, because the world's going to change completely. And the way that we thought things were going is not going to be the way it goes anymore. And that's where I think nonprofits find themselves, is what direction, what path do we go? And how do we muster enough energy to get there? And so I wanted to bring you on because you've got a really interesting concept with the term grit. And I'd love you to kind of walk us through that, because if anything that nonprofits need right now is a sense of grit and determination that they're going to survive and thrive out of this new world that we're going to live in. And I think we need some help doing that. So I brought you on. Let's talk about it. Grit, what is it? Your definition. And let's start there, shall we?
Yeah, you know, grit, it actually kind of started with an Air Force buddy of mine about 6-7 years ago, when we got into real estate, and he coined the term, or not really coined the term, but our holding company was called True Grit, which is what our holding company up here is called. And, you know, it's being true to grit, right? So when I think of grit, what I think of is I think of grace, I think of being resilient, I think of being intentional, and I think of trust. You know, grace during these challenging times is trying to understand who people are and where they're coming from. You know, because we're all being hit in different ways by the pandemic, whether that be financially, you know, some people are having to homeschool and do their jobs and then attempt to homeschool some more and then attempt to do their job again. And really you're like, what the hell actually got accomplished today? You know, the resilient part is kind of a little bit about that too, but it's also, you know, how do we pivot and how do we face this thing head on? Because, you know, quite frankly, we're at the worst our economy has been in terms of loss of jobs. You know, they say what now, 1 in every 9 people doesn't have a job. So those of us who are fortunate to be working, how do we be resilient? How do we help the other ones out who don't right now?
Yes.
And doctors, nurses, people at the grocery store, you know, they've got to show up with quite a bit of resilience every day. But it's how do we put one foot in front of the other? You know, and then intentionality. You know, when this whole thing started, I got together this this spreadsheet, and on the bottom of the spreadsheet was, what is the different room that we're going to clean every day, or how are we going to organize? The top of the spreadsheet was, how many miles am I going to run that day? What type of lift are we going to do to keep ourselves mentally and physically healthy? Because I think a lot of this is, you know, staying physically active is keeping yourself mentally healthy, but also, you know, scheduling a time so you're also having goals to meet and being very intentional about where you're spending your time is going to help you. I'm sure you found that out as well. And then the last piece of this is trust. You know, the more we trust, the faster we accomplish, but at the same time, the more we trust, the faster we fail. So I look at that and say, I'm a pretty trusting guy, which is why I think I live life at about a Mach 12 when we're going through it. But I also learn a lot. You know, and I've probably failed more oftentimes than people would care to know, but that's just who I am. And I think for every failure, I find out who I am a little bit more and how to solve the next problem. But I do fully believe in trust, because we as a society can't move forward. We as business owners, we as employees, we as friends, we as a community, if we don't trust each other, we're not going very far. And if we are, it's kind of a lie. You know, so eventually that stuff falls through.
I think this applies so well to the nonprofit world. You know, it's that grace, resiliency, intentionality, and trust. I mean, this is exactly what I think the nonprofit world needs to hear right now. Let's talk about grace. Mm-hmm. We've never done this before as a society, at least this generation, right? This is exponentially weirder than 2008. This is exponentially weirder than anything in the 1980s, 1970s. This is just plain weird. And nobody was ready for it. It doesn't matter if you're a government entity or some business owner, we're all not ready for this. Mm-hmm. And I think one of the things we need to grant ourselves in the nonprofit world is grace, to understand that we are doing the best that we possibly can, and to forgive ourselves if we don't do anything perfectly. What about grace do we need to understand that maybe we're not thinking about, that you've kind of thought about and ruminated about for, you know, this pandemic that we're going through?
Yeah, and I think you hit the nail on the head there. We're not going to be perfect, so let's make sure we're not. And let's give ourselves the volume of grace that, you know, from a nonprofit standpoint, if you're out fundraising and you're not getting the money you're seeking, that is not that big of an issue right now. Because right now we should be cultivating relationships. You know, now at some point, obviously for businesses, you know, even for profit like ours to survive, we're going to need to sell. It's a timing thing, you know? So as long as we're cultivating, building big relationships, that's a powerful thing. You know, I was talking with our new sales gal, Lacey, you know, and even our president, Bethany, and our vice president, Katie, and our director of ops, Naomi. You know, we talk a lot about grace right now because in our world, you know, we're not moving as fast as we want to move. We're not putting on the programs that we want to be putting on. And everyone feels, you know, somewhat handcuffed and unproductive. And how do you mentally face that when you're so used to being productive? You know, and talk about how do you give yourself a little bit of grace? And furthermore, how do we give our teammates grace? You know, how do we celebrate some of those wins? So you think nonprofit world, hey, you're supposed to go raise, you know, maybe it's 10 grand a month and you're sitting at two. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's look at, you know, you've got, where are we at now? You probably got 7 months left to do fundraising. You're probably in real aspects only going to have 3 months to do that. Right. So maybe there's an expectation shift, but then maybe there's other creative ways to look at this and saying, okay, I'm going to give myself a little grace, but I'm also going to get kind of creative. You know, can we do subscriptions? Are there other ways that we can get these people locked in for doing different things? Maybe there's a creative way that we can reduce cost, you know, so the same thing, the bottom line stays the same. So I think giving yourself some grace on what the expectation is moving forward, but then also shifting your mindset to how creative can I get right now?
And I think that you are going to be forgiven from your donor base, your supporter base. I think you should be, if you're a board member, you better be giving out grace for those who are trying something different and new. I think people are going to be excited about you trying new things and sloughing off the idea of this is the way we've always done it is this way. And I think your ability to think outside of the box will be forgiven if it doesn't go the way that you thought it was going to go, because you tried and you attempted. And I think that alone is going to resonate with those who have supported you this entire time. And it's okay to take a risk at this point. It's okay to do that because people are going to give you a long list of ability to just be forgiven for trying something different. And I think grace is really thing that we need to understand in the nonprofit world. Resiliency though, if there's ever a group of individuals, it is those who work in the nonprofit world that are going to embrace the idea of resiliency. You've been doing it your whole life, folks. You know, you work on a shoestring budget, you're resilient about that. You find an ups and downs that a donor passes away and doesn't give you all his money, but you're resilient, you figure it out. Why is resiliency such an important part of being in a nonprofit, the same way that it is from a business standpoint?
I think, I mean, just in life in general, it's the reason we succeed.
Yeah.
You know, there's maybe 1% of the society that is extremely successful, and however you define success, they're successful by accident. You know, the majority of us have to fail 9 times out of 10, you know, whether that would be in business, whether that be in relationships, whether that would be, you know, in school, but we fail so we can succeed in something else further along down the line. You know, you look at right now, let's go back 3 weeks ago, you know, to the first week of the pandemic. I mean, how many people felt like they were failing as parents and as educators and whatnot, when you don't know how to help your son or daughter with homework, or you didn't know how to use the functions of Zoom, or you didn't know how to reach out to people when you're not used to doing in-person stuff. Well, you think of how resilient we are now. Zoom is a verb, right? I think sweatpants, like we dress like a mullet, right? We're on sweatpants on bottom, and then some people wear dress shirts on top. I prefer to just wear a hoodie most days. But we've all adjusted and we've become pretty resilient to it. And I think we do it without even knowing, you know, and we just don't recognize how resilient we truly are. When I look out my window, I see more people running and working out during the last 4 weeks than I have in the last 2 years I've lived in Fargo. I think we're starting to get that mindset of resiliency, But in order for us to be successful, I think that has to be our big pillar, right? But we can't do it without giving ourselves grace. Like if you go home and you beat yourself up every night about, oh my gosh, I didn't do this right today, I didn't do this, versus, hey, I'm attacking this like I'm a startup right now. Hey, everything is new, everything is different. I'm going to give myself a little bit of grace because I'm just going to solve the next problem followed by the next. And I think that's what's important is be resilient, just solve one problem at a time.
And I think it's really taking the time to realize that you've been resilient. And I think we don't acknowledge it because we do it naturally. I think we adjust accordingly. My kids are acting up. I got to do this differently. That's resilience. And I think pausing to realize that you have been resilient in these times that nobody's really expected to do anything, that's really step one. And then again, like you said, giving the grace to forgive yourself for not being perfect, because none of us are. Instagram isn't real. It's okay, right? Everything you see on social media, it's all just the best parts of what you want to see. And I think it's even more obnoxious now that nobody's being, you know, the reality is that we're all in the same boat. Our kids are acting up and we've got businesses that are just exploding all over the place and we just don't know where things are going. Everybody is in the same place. So it's okay to do that. But really there comes a time where you're going to have to make a move, right? You're going to have to make and I hate the term now. We need to figure out what a new word for pivot is, but like, because I keep using that GIF from Friends, the pivot. I've been using it.
In the stairway with a couch.
Yes. I've been using it an obnoxious amount of times and it's fun. Okay. But we're all going to have to make that pivot. And now we're going to have to get into the idea of intentionality. Because at some point in time, we're going to have to choose a direction and go. Mm-hmm. Talk to me a little bit about intentionality and how we can use that in the nonprofit world.
Well, I think intentionality is really driven by purpose. Mm. And what I mean by that is, you know, a lot of us, we have a struggle with being really efficient or effective, depending on what term you want to use. But for us to be super intentional, we need to have to find our purpose. If I don't think this is worth my time, it's really hard for me to be 100% honestly intentional about serving others, right? Within the Dale Carnegie frame or within a coaching or a teaching frame. So it's the same thing with a nonprofit. What is your purpose? What is the purpose of the nonprofit? It's a question I often ask people when they're calling to raise money, right? Or they're calling for us to go donate our time, which I absolutely love doing. But, you know, often the question is, well, what's the purpose of your organization? Yeah. And then you give the 5,000 foot overview. And then you ask, what is the purpose? Like, what is your purpose for doing this? Like, truly, who are you serving? How are you serving? What are you serving? And so I think for them or for, you know, people in the nonprofit world, if we truly understand our purpose in the company, our purpose or the purpose for the organization, what we're raising money for, how we're doing it, the why we're doing it, the piece of becoming intentional becomes easy. Then you have your reason to wake up every day. You have your reason to, you know, go for your run at 6 a.m. because you know you need to be mentally ready. You know you need the enough energy to get out and get rejected 300 times and get 2 yeses and then, you know, ring your sales bell or whatever you got going on. So to me, it's all about purpose. If I know my purpose for whatever I'm doing in life, I can be very intentional. If I don't know my purpose, it's really hard for me to stay on track.
This is a great time to figure out or realign your true north. And whether mm-hmm. that's personal or professional in the nonprofit world, what's your true north? And get back to mission. If you had mission creep and you can't figure out, somebody asks you, well, what do you do? And it takes you 30 minutes and you don't have that elevator pitch ring out. This is a really nice time to hone in back on what your original purpose was and to really think about and reflect, are we there? Are we doing what we're supposed to be doing? Are we really making the impact we should? I mean, this, if you're going to talk about intentionality, this is a wonderful time to be intentional about what you're training on, who you're talking with, what you're talking about, who you're impacting, what your mission is. Get back to that true north. And I think more than ever now, you've got the time to do that. What a wonderful gift I think as a nonprofit leader having is this time to realign and get back to what you did in the first place. And that really, I think, makes a wonderful transition to the idea of trust. If what you're doing right now does not elicit trust from the public, you're in a major bind when it comes to fundraising. But outside of that, why is trust a thing that we need to pay attention to more than ever now, especially when we're sort of dealing with a global pandemic?
Well, to me, trust is what makes the world go round, because, trust is the basis of all relationships. So if we go back to, let's talk about how you and I had first met, right?
Yeah.
Rebecca Undum says, hey, there's this guy I need you to meet. And I didn't know Rebecca from anybody else at that time. He's a great guy, similar value system. You'll really like him. Within a minute, I was like, all right, I trust this guy. Same value system. You could just tell, right? So I knew that we could trust each other, and in turn, at some point in time, we could help each other out in business and in life and as friends. If you don't have that right now, who are you going to lean on? And how are you truly going to move forward without losing a ton of sleep at night? If you don't trust now, you're in this cycle of crazy, almost depression, because you're working, probably 70, 80, 90 hours a week. You don't trust anybody else. So you're holding on to everything that's going on. And you're just overworking, and you don't have any outlets in the community because you're stuck indoors. The other piece is if we don't trust, you're climbing a mountain by yourself. It's lonely at the top, and two, it's really hard to get there without a support team. Mm-hmm. So by trusting each other and within reason, trust is earned. So let's understand that it's not like, hey, you're going to go out and, someone's going to make you a promise that they're going to, donate all this money and they don't follow up. That's not what we're talking about. We're talking about, have we cultivated a relationship? Do we understand our clients? Or do we understand our donors? Do we understand our teammates? And do I know enough about them? Have I created enough of a relationship so I trust what's coming out of their mouth? Or do I trust my teammate enough to say, hey, can you do this? We have a challenge going on right now. Can you help us out? A great example, our president Bethany is going on maternity leave tomorrow. Her and I were talking on Wednesday and just said, hey, how you feeling? She's like, well, I'm actually feeling pretty good about everything because, I've done everything I could. And, I trust everyone else on the team and they're going to do what they need to do. And so I'm good. And I mean, that's tough. Like, you're going to be out for a couple months. So, if we can all kind of get to that level with each other, I think we're in a much better spot. But some people just have that tendency where they're going to hold back this is not the time to do that. This is the time to get out of your comfort zone. And maybe it's asking tough questions. Maybe it's getting to know people you necessarily wouldn't get to know. But whatever you need to do to get out of that comfort zone, to understand that person or that client or the donor, to trust them enough to do their job, start taking those steps.
And I think donors are looking for organizations that they can trust now too. You know that everybody with high capacity is being asked to donate to every single nonprofit that has your phone number, email address, or anything. That's just the nature of this right now. Everybody's looking at it. Donors are looking for organizations they can trust. So are you connecting with them and asking questions?
Yep.
That have nothing to do with the size of their checkbook, but everything to do with what they love and what they're passionate about. That's building a block and a foundation of trust so that they know that you're not just interested in their money, but you're interested in them feeling great about where they're going to give their money or invest or how they want to make an impact and a leaving impact in this world. And I think that's unbelievably valuable, is to spend this time earning that. Because people want to give, they want to help, but they don't necessarily trust every single person that's calling them because they don't know where the money's going to go. Tell them where they want that, like ask them where they want it to go. Ask them to try to match up your values and try to figure out how you can build a relationship more than you can to build an account and a fund for your organization. And this is really where I think that trust is exponentially more important, like you said, right now, more than ever. And this is why I love this idea of grit. It's that grace and resiliency and that intentionality and that trust that's so important right now. You put all those things together. If you run with that as a nonprofit right now, I think you're going to come out of this pretty great. And I think you're going to have a path to go. And what a wonderful feeling that you can have to know that when this thing opens up a little bit, whenever that is,
yeah,
you're going to have a path forward, and that's going to make you sleep better at night, isn't it?
Oh, well, it should, you know.
I think so.
Yeah. You think about it. I mean, it definitely has helped us, right? And it's definitely helped me because we're not all that different from a nonprofit. Some of the things I do on the side is, you know, either with nonprofits or a lot in the education, which is basically a nonprofit.
Yeah.
And you sleep a heck of a lot better when you know you're making traction and progress, when you do trust, when you're intentional with your time, which helps you become resilient and you give yourself a little grace while doing it. That's a much better life to live than beating yourself up over every little thing that, you know, doesn't go right. You know, let's focus on what did go well. Let's build relationships, you know, let's build them slow. But let's make sure that they're there. Let's ask a ton of questions. Let's understand when and who to trust. And once that happens, I think you see a lot of things take off. You know, for me personally, the people that we donate to or the organizations that we help are the people who spent a lot of time getting to know me. And sometimes it didn't take long. You know, sometimes it was a week. I was like, I love this guy. You know, like I'd do anything for him. Like, yeah, let me do whatever I can to help you out, you know, within reason, obviously.
Yeah.
But that's really what's done it. And I think right now is a great time to cultivate that.
I think this conversation is very needed. And I think it is so overdue that I think a lot of nonprofits need to take the time and kind of listen to this. And I am forever grateful for your time today. As always, it's a joy to chat with you. But let's just say that people aren't, no, I need more. I need more Jay. Yeah. I need to know, find out where he's doing, what he's doing. How do people get a hold of you? How do people get a hold of Dale Carnegie? How can they contract with you, get to pick your brain, whatever the case may be? Give us the info on how people can reach out and chat with you.
Yeah. Well, me personally, you can follow me on pretty much any social media it's usually at my first name, JJY, last name Peltier. Pelter, and that, you know, Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, LinkedIn. You can follow us on majority of those. It would be Dale Carnegie NDMN, which stands for North Dakota, and then we also own portions of Northwest Minnesota. You know, I would check us out online. Go check out our website as well. We have a ton of cool programs that are starting this summer. You know, some of the Dale Carnegie courses, which is about building trust and relationships. I think that's a great one for anybody. We've had a lot of nonprofit people come through that one. And then we're actually starting a new one there's half of it is for advanced leaders and the other, or for advanced managers. And the other half of that program is for, new managers. So there's two separate leadership programs that are coming through. Those are going to be really, really cool. We actually just kicked those off, worldwide as a Dale Carnegie organization in January, and we're just getting them going through North Dakota here this summer. So those would be kind of the real big ones I think would be cool, as long as our high impact presentation, which we have coming up in July. But any information you want on that, you know, you can definitely get a hold of me, or, you know, go to our website and sign up for one of our programs.
Outstanding. And of course, all those links are going to be in the show notes. Yep. So it makes it a lot easier for you, the listener or the viewer, depending on where you are listening and watching the official Do Good Better podcast. Jay, thank you so much for being a guest today. I needed this personally to talk about this. I'm sure a lot of nonprofits needed to hear and listen to this today. And can't thank you enough for your time given to us and the viewing and the listening audience. Thank you, my friend, for being a guest on the official Do Good Better podcast.
Yeah, thanks for having me, Patrick. Appreciate it.